Please join me in giving a round of applause for Ron Robinson.
Thank you, Lauren. Even getting Kanisha's right, that's very unusual. I appreciate that. Thank you very much, Lauren. It's great to be with you. I want to thank you again for being with us this weekend. This session is really to deal ultimately with what is the conservative philosophy, what is the underlying principles when we talk about the conservative movement. In the last half hour, you had an opportunity to delve into that, and we're going to probe through questions what you concluded was most important for conservatism. We don't want anyone leaving this conference without a pretty good grasp of what conservatives believe their movement is. It is so important that you leave with that, and there will be other speakers that will amplify on those aspects of our movement. But in one of the reasons I think it's so important is because if you go to personalities, if you look the way the news media covers major liberals versus or progressives, whatever term you prefer, versus major conservatives or free, freedom-oriented movement people, you will see the systematic attack and undermining of the conservative personalities. And you will see a consistent promotion of the liberal personalities. So for the first few minutes, I'm going to underscore that by using basically the covers of Time Magazine. This is a presentation that I've actually given to the editors of Time Magazine. So it's been, in one version or another, well-tested, well-probed. I gave them the opportunity, or they gave me the opportunity to present it and for them to rebut it. But the rebuttal never convinced me to change anything. There was one case they made on one item, and maybe that'll pop up today. But I do that at the beginning. But this session will fully use the hour that we have. Unlike all the other sessions, I think, where the questions come at the end, you're free to ask and intervene at any point with any questions you have, because the clock will run out and we won't have time for Q&A. So if you have a question along the way, don't hesitate to speak right up and get to it. So as to how conservatives are treated, basically any given week you see on newsstands, Time Magazine, and you basically could say that's a fair cover story. By the way, Time concedes that you should judge it by the cover. They view their covers as iconic, so this is not an unfair way of judging a book by its cover. They would readily admit and do that you should judge Time by its cover. So that is a point that they will concede. So this particular week, for example, you have, this is Donald Trump, total meltdown. So I give that as an example. If you see that on the newsstands this week, you wouldn't say this is particularly outside the realm of what is reasonable. What you will miss, though, by looking at it from week to week is the pattern. And that's what I want to share with you this morning. First, by going over some of the issues that the left does, and I'm going to try to do this pretty quickly, and then going into how the personalities are treated. So here's a good example as they hype the racial issues. Newsweek still published, not as frequently as Time, but again, you can pretty much judge the covers pretty much by how they promote particular issues. So here's the perilous fight of Kaepernick not standing up for the national anthem. Black Lives Matters, when they wanted to promote that as a movement, it got a cover of Time Magazine. The religious case for gay marriage. The only way you will see religion on the cover of Time or Newsweek or promoted as a major positive is if they're promoting some underlying leftist theme. So you will see religion used in a positive context, but only when they twist it, I would say twist it, to promote some other underlying leftist position. And here, basically suggesting that the Bible is totally in league with the current gay rights movement in redefining marriage. The Constitution, does it still matter? The left undermining the Constitution. You're gonna see, I think, in one of the films we show, President Obama's comments that it's an outdated. This is a part of their attack on marriage. Who needs marriage? So first they undermine the purpose of marriage, they undermine traditional marriage, and then they try to redefine it. Again, here's using religion to promote the gay rights movement, the freedom fight. The only time they would probably put a cross and a favorable cover of Time. The battle of the bathroom on transsexuals being in the bathroom. These are just some examples of how you would see these on a given week, but you don't see the overall pattern in constant promoting. Is America homophobic? Are we really responsible as a country for our problems with Islam? Or is there no suggestion that there might be something inherently aggressive about a religion that promotes a jihadist underlying philosophy? The Capitalist Manifesto basically suggesting that capitalism is outdated, basically comparing it to the Communist Manifesto. We are all socialists now. This was probably in 2009, so this is not a real recent one, but it pretty much sums up what the media tries to suggest to the American people and to your fellow students. And now we shift to how liberals and progressives are portrayed by the media. You have to understand that this is what they try to sell to your fellow students. So you may not agree with these particular pictures, but this is what's being absorbed by your colleagues. And this is why it's so important to get to the underlying idea of what conservative philosophy is and what conservative values are. Because you're not going to win on personality fights. The personality fights is going to be defined by the wider culture, and it's going to constantly seek to bring out the faults of any conservative, and it's going to constantly promote the virtues of any liberals. So you're going to consistently see great smiles and very positive covers of different people. These are some of the times when the nominees were made by the Democratic Party, the contenders, the Sunshine Boys. I want you to absorb some of the terms they're using as they're promoting these pictures. The Sunshine Boys is a good one. Reno, the real thing. She was a pretty obscure, the third nominee for the Attorney General. The other two were basically had tax problems. The icons, Justice Ginsburg being one of the great Supreme Court icons. Barack Obama, when he was first presented, this is before he was even a United States Senator, he was presented to the American people as the person who was going to bring the country together. If you take red and blue states, and you merge it into one color, you come up with purple. And so this is a theme from the very beginning of then State Senator Barack Obama, that he was going to be the person to unite an otherwise divided country. There were many, there was over 40 very positive pictures. This is actually not when he won the presidency, but this is when he was emerging as the winner of the nomination. They were already crowning him. Here is another great example of mixing religion as a positive, putting a rainbow halo over the president, calling him the first gay president. Again, the only time they use religion is to denigrate core religious positions. They use President Reagan from time to time, who was obviously very popular with the American people, to validate liberal points of view or to suggest that Reagan would be disgusted with the modern conservative movement. So why Obama loved Reagan? If you think Obama's philosophy and approach is showing love for Reagan, I got some share of the Brooklyn Bridge I want to sell you. God of all things. Why Joe is no joke? Joe Biden was selected because he was the Democratic version of the person that if Obama was president, no one would want anything to happen to him, because Joe Biden was considered such a joke in Washington that they wouldn't want him to ascend to the presidency. But everyone considered him a joke, so he's portrayed on the cover of Newsweek as no joke. Bernie is more recent, Socialize This America, very positive cover. And again, I want you to have this image in your mind, because when we shift to the conservatives, you're not going to see smiling faces and very positive portrayal. How far will Bernie go? This is one of the early ones of Hillary Clinton. This one is even more important. This is when she was getting ready to run for senator in New York. It's her turn. There is no other person in American politics that Time or Newsweek has ever put on the cover and proclaimed that person, it was their turn to take a particular office. But Hillary Clinton got that when she was going to run for senator in New York. If I actually go back, you'll see her brown eyes. She found by polling that blue eyes are more popular. So this is Hillary in her own words. True story. That's not just being facetious. What Hillary believes and why she thinks she'll win. I found my own voice. You're going to see many, many of these. Hear Her Roar. Very positive covers of Time and Newsweek. The Fighter, in a positive way. Not a fighter in any negative way. Very positive pictures. The State of Hillary. Will she make the world a more peaceful world? Will she make it a more peaceful world? The Rise of Smart Power. You're never going to see... You're never going to see any conservative associated with smartness. I know what it's like to be knocked down. So she has problems, a very sympathetic cover. The Search of Hillary. This was probably the most critical one of Hillary, but that's it. And you're going to see some ones on the conservative side. Can anyone stop Hillary? I assume this is Bernie Sanders holding onto her heel. The Clinton Way. Obama is wrong, but this is a leftist perspective of why Obama's wrong, not a conservative one. Now we're going to shift to the conservatives, and I can probably go through that pretty quickly. Pat Buchanan was the communications director for Ronald Reagan. He was presented three times on the cover of Time and Newsweek as Hellraiser, Preaching Fear, and Bully Boy. That's the only presentations they had of him. Hellraiser, Preaching Fear, Bully Boy. Newt Gingrich, on the verge of becoming Speaker of the House, was portrayed as mad as hell. Anyone who knew Newt at that time knew he was happy as could be, but they portrayed him as being just mad. This is my all-time favorite. Before he even became Speaker, between the election and when he took office as Speaker, he was Uncle Scrooge. "'Tis the season to bash the poor. Is Newt Gingrich's America really that heartless?" So again, this is the kind of things that the general public absorbs. This first 100 days, who will benefit and who will be hurt? Suggesting if you advance conservatism. This is the one that I said the actual editors of Time magazine, we had an exchange on this. I said it was Man of the Year, and it was the first time they had put the Man of the Year on the cover with a 5 o'clock shadow. And the editor said to me, we gave him an opportunity to shave. So I said, well, I will... account for that in the future, but he opted not to do that. But then one of the editors said, yes, but remember, we colored it green and yellow to make him look sinister. So true story, right out of the mouths of the editors of Time magazine. The Loser, The Fall of Newt, The Audacity of Newt. This is Rush Limbaugh. I think Limbaugh's appeared three times here with Howard Stern, screaming into the microphone, looking like a madman. Is it good for America? Of course, that's the best you can get is a question mark. He became very popular. This is one of two covers where Time airbrushed and changed the photo. They photoshopped the smoke to make him look a little bit more sinister. Russia's World of Pain, Enough, so there's four covers. The conservative case against Limbaugh. Madman, Glenn Beck. President Bush, question mark, like, is this guy even capable of being president? Bushwhacked. Love him and hate him. This was probably a consistent theme during the Bush years. At best, you would have a split opinion of him. Bush's world, comparing it with Truman's world. What Bush knew, suggesting that he knew about 9/11 in advance. The verdict on Cheney, this was not a verdict on Cheney at all. It was on his aide that was eventually... It was a very questionable attack, but they make it look like it was Cheney that was convicted. John Ashcroft, the Attorney General of the United States. I gave you Janet Reno. Some of these, if I had longer, I would give you the direct comparison. But remember, Reno was the real thing. John Ashcroft is bringing holy war to be an Attorney General of the United States. Should this man be the Attorney General? He had been the Attorney General of Missouri. He had been its governor. He had been a senator. He had run for president. How do you solve a problem like Sarah? So Sarah Palin was presented as a problem. Ted Cruz, I barely even recognize Ted Cruz in this photo. But this is probably as negative a picture as you can make and question whether he's likable. The Queen of Rage, Congressman Michelle Bachmann. Again, if you go back to the Sunshine Boys and compare it with what the liberals are suggested. And now we move to Trump, the elephant in the room. Why don't they like me? This is a Mitt Romney one in the past. The wimp factor, again, contrast these to the happy smiles. Deal with it like it's a real problem. That still is probably his best cover. Gut check with just the back of the Trump. How Trump won When they go to black and white, they're trying to suggest someone's older and more out of touch. You can see that consistently if you look at all the covers. I don't have time today to go into great detail of that, but again, be alert, and the black and white cover is usually negative. Here he is, he's bully, he's a showman, he's a party crasher, he's a demagogue. You have to decide whether he should be the 45th president of the United States, but if your fellow students see that lineup, there's no question how they'll answer that. The Art of the Bad Deal, so making fun of his book. Meltdown, this is an early version of this week's, so this is a repeat. This is came earlier in the year, in August, but you're actually seeing this week's one as an updated version of that, and that's this week. So I give you that as the background, as what you're up against in presenting your ideas. And this is why it's so important that you understand the core conservative philosophy, because your fellow students are going to start out thinking there's something wrong with conservatives. There's something nicked about these people, when they'll never see that about the left. And that's why you, it's been a big part of the philosophy of Saul Alinsky is just attack relentlessly other people presenting conservative ideas or ideas different than his radical ideas. Saul Alinsky's book is a very leftist book. It was actually dedicated to Lucifer. It pretty much presents the leftist philosophy that Lucifer probably would be very comfortable with. But who dedicates a book to Lucifer? But his idea was attack conservatives. Don't let people think about the conservative ideas. Let them think about the faults of people presenting conservative personalities. And the mainline news media will do everything they can to make conservative leaders look like they're fundamentally flawed. So let's go to what conservatism is. Why don't we begin with Group A? We'll begin with Group A. Who who's the spokesman for Group A? Jolie, you are?
No, A1.
I mean, we have multiple A's? Three A's. A1, how are you? Ron Robinson.
David Hancock.
David, nice to have you with us. Why don't you bring out a couple of the items that you, your group thought was most important in the conservative philosophy?
All right, so we are Group A1. I like to call us steak sauce. But, our three big points that we all decided were the most important in the conservative movement were pro-life, limited government, and the American dream. Elaborating on those, pro-life is the right to life as conservatives. Oh, yay, am I not loud enough?
Can everyone
TV
hear me?
TV audience, I think.
Yeah.
Don't want to hear
So, as conservatives, we believe that life starts with the embryo, and that once the life has started, they have all the same rights that we do as teens, since we're not actually adults yet. And the freedom of religion also goes into that. The second point is limited government. It allows less taxation, especially for small businesses, and in turn, that can help them be able to hire more hands, get more work done, and just lose less money, which everyone loves. And that is part of the Constitution.
Those are your three big. Any questions for David on those?
One more.
Okay, go ahead. Sure.
Sorry.
And the American dream, which is equality of opportunity, which is different than equality of, what was it? Outcome. There it is.
Results. Yeah.
Results. So equality of opportunity, you have to put some work in. It's not handed to you, which is the generation of entitlement that we live in. They all believe that, why should I work if the guy who's going to work will get just as much as I should, and that doesn't make sense to work hard because I can just coast on the government's money and live my life. So the American dream is actually putting yourself forward, working hard so that you can make a life for your family and work your way up through society. Yeah, I think that's it.
David, you did a good job. Have you done this before?
No.
You may have a career in it. Any questions for David about any of those points? Thank you very much.
Goodness.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks.
That's the A1 sauce. What is this, A2? This is, what is it?
B1.
Is there another A?
Yeah.
All right, who's A2? Who wants to represent A2? David covered a lot of ground, so it doesn't leave you as much. Good to have you with us again. Your name? Sabrina, great to have you with us. So you've done this once before, right?
Yes.
So is that fair?
No.
Life's not fair, right?
Hello. Okay. So our three big points were individualism, God-given rights, and then the Constitution. So that, like, those are very, like, broad terms. But for the Constitution, our two big things were the First Amendment for freedom of speech and then freedom of religion. So we just found that as, like, a conservative, that's very important to be able to speak your mind and not be able or, like, not have that impinged on. And then the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, as a lot of conservatives believe that, you know, you should be able to carry a gun and a weapon for your own safety. And then God-given rights, we kind of align that with, like, natural rights, that everybody's born with either God-given rights or natural rights based on whether you're religious or not. And then individualism, just, like, to be your own person and to believe what you want. So those were our three big things.
Good. And very good. How is God-given rights tied to the United States Constitution? Anything you want to share on that?
Well, in our Pledge of Allegiance, we say under God. And then also that's just kind of like our nation was founded on the belief of Christianity. And so along those lines, that's just what we were thinking.
Most of the founding fathers were Christians, to be sure. I think one of the points I would want to bring out is, and this deals with American exceptionalism. Sometimes when you think about the way the media portrays American exceptionalism, and President Obama adopted this particular point of view, it's the United States is great. We produce a lot of, you know, good products. We're great people. And in the film, you'll see he'll say, the British believe the British are exceptional, and the Greeks believe the Greeks are exceptional. What really makes American exceptionalism, what's at the heart of it, is tied to what Sabrina talked about in God-giving rights in the United States Constitution. Our founding fathers believed that the rights we have come from God, not from the government. And the Constitution, and particularly the Bill of Rights, basically reaffirms that these are rights that government should have no ability to impinge on. They don't give us those rights. We have those rights. They pre-existed the founding of the United States. They're God-given. That's the heart of American exceptionalism. American exceptionalism believes that this was the first country founded on the idea that we don't derive our powers and our rights from governments or from kings, but we derive it from God, and government has to adjust itself to that concept. That's the core belief of American exceptionalism, and Sabrina, your group captured it in the combination of God-given rights and the Constitution, because they're entwined with each other. Thank you very much. Any questions for Sabrina? Good job. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Is this A3? Now, when you come up, I'd urge you, even if it wasn't the principal part of what your group said, but to try to add new points to it. You've done this before as well.
Yes, sir.
So, Carter, glad to have you with us again. Why don't you bring out three points that haven't been brought out so far?
Okay, well, I think the ones I've circled were mostly brought out, but right. We have limited government. Just big government equals big problems, and the larger the government, the less power to the individual. So we mentioned that. We also mentioned traditional values, so traditional Christian values, traditional family values in the home. This one was already mentioned with the Constitution. Individual freedom is another good one. Just freedom to the individual to do as they wish in a free enterprise economy. So,
good. Carl, let me ask you, give me in your own words a couple of the advantages of limited government. What makes limited government better than unlimited government?
I think having an unlimited government allows economies to really flourish, and if there's you know, just a ton of government regulations and stuff like that that they have to adhere to. It makes it really difficult for small businesses and small business owners to really develop a profitable business. And I think that small businesses in this country are really, really important in that it creates jobs and wonderful opportunities.
Any other reasons why you favor limited government that you think of?
There's more power to the individual person.
All right. And why is that important? Why is it better for an individual to make a decision than a society for
because
that individual?
If you have a really large government, it's going to be hard for a large government to meet a specific person's needs.
And
the big government isn't going to know, you know, an individual's needs better than that individual.
You agree with that? Yeah. So let me give you an example of that you can use with your liberals and progressive students. Liberals would say, in answer probably to Carter, this is democracy. We decide to do things as a society. It's a village. It takes a village to raise a child and so on, not just individualism. You can't do it on your own. And if you think about that, think about some of the things that are important to your fellow students. Let me suggest a couple. Music and perhaps the internet. If you take music for a second, unlimited government would basically say, look, there is a need for the government to regulate music. Some of it is not very highbrow. You know, if you make your individual choices, you're probably not going to choose the Santa Barbara Philharmonic Orchestra. And they're going to lose a job, and culture is going to be undermined. They're probably going to say only a few big music companies control much of the market, and we need to regulate those companies. They're probably going to say there's great inequity. Some of you may own, 100 tunes. Some of you may own 1,000 tunes. How many here have more than 1,000 tunes on your music, whatever you're using? Over 1,000. Raise your hand high if you have over 1,000. Keep your hands up if you have over 2,000. So we got at least 3 or 4 people with 2,000. Keep your hands if you got over 3,000 tunes in your thing. Think of the inequity. You have over 3,000 tunes. Two of you have over 3,000 tunes. Some of you probably only have a few hundred. That's exactly what a liberal would say. That's not fair. But this is the core of limited government. In limited government, it says you make that decision. You don't have, if you're a citizen of California, you don't have to go to Barbara Boxer and Dianne Feinstein to lobby for the kind of music that you want. You can make that decision. So you can make all the arguments for society making those decisions for you, but you and your fellow students know in your heart that we're better off with whatever inequities there are, that these two colleagues have 3,000 tunes, but so what? I get to choose the tunes I want. I don't have to go lobby for it. I don't have to rely on government. That is individualism, and that's limited government. So I wanted to bring that out because there's a lot of advantages of limited government. Let me give you one other, because limited government is so critical to the conservative movement's philosophy. The left sometimes talks about the divisiveness in the United States. They would like everybody to agree with liberal policies and be happy with them. And whenever they think the population's unhappy with liberal governance, they start talking about the need for civility and for everyone being in agreement. What I would suggest to you when government is not limited is you end up having many more disputes with your fellow citizens. If I have to go to Washington to lobby for the kind of school that my children are going to attend, and Washington's going to decide what kind of light bulbs I use and how much water I have in my toilet, and government says how much I have to put away for retirement, or government tells me how long my fellow colleagues here in Santa Barbara can work in a given day before we pay them a different amount, all those type of decisions, we end up fighting over those decisions. And we want to control government because we want to make those decisions for ourselves. When government makes more and more of those decisions, you end up in confrontation with fellow Americans because you want what you want to raise your own family, you want to live your own life, but government is telling you more and more. So that is why the job you did, Carter, in bringing out limited government is so important. It's a couple of the other reasons for it. It keeps us, allowing us to not view our fellow citizens as adversaries, but live and let live. How many tunes do you have in your?
Probably about 100.
Well, there you go. So you shouldn't feel deprived. You probably got the 100 that you enjoy. And so what that those spoiled brats back there have 3,000, right? Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Thanks. Thank you. Give Carter a hand. Let me give you the microphone so we.
Yeah, I'm going to quote Thomas Jefferson. Yeah, I need a microphone for that. A quote comes to mind in Thomas Jefferson. He said, "A government that's big enough to give you everything you want is big enough to take everything you have." And I think that
it's a key point. And government can take everything that you have. They come in and close down businesses. They seize people's income, oftentimes erroneously. Increasingly without a court order. And so you don't see that necessarily in your lives yet, but you'll see it if you go into business, you'll see it in other circumstances. But Mr. Gaby quoted Thomas Jefferson. What's the problem with quoting Thomas Jefferson? Anyone, you hear it in your classrooms. What's the problem with Thomas Jefferson? What is it?
He was a slave owner.
How many of you heard that he's a slave owner? How many of you can tell me another core concept of Thomas Jefferson that you're taught about Thomas Jefferson in your school? Anyone? What is it? A deist. So you've learned that he's a slaveholder. You learned he's a deist. What else have we learned about Thomas Jefferson in our classrooms? Anyone? So you don't learn very much about Thomas Jefferson. The Declaration of Independence. Yes. So you take a break from listening to your 3,000 tunes to study these things, huh? Okay, all right. I think, let me deal with this before I go to another board. The founding fathers are always under attack. How many of you believe that a majority of the signers of the U.S. Constitution were slaveholders? Majority? How many believe a majority of the signers of the Declaration of Independence were slaveholders? Have you heard that? Raise your hand if you've heard that. Do you know that both of those are wrong? That it's a minority, and the founding fathers sought a way to eliminate slavery. They couldn't form the country and do so all in one fell swoop. Most of the countries in the late 18th century hadn't abolished slavery. The United States was not significantly different than any other country, but they were seeking a way to do it, and that was part of the discussion. It was part of why they came to conclusions like restricting the trade slave in D.C. at a certain point. But the majority of the founding fathers were not slaveholders. But it's the left's constant attack of the founding fathers of this country because they don't believe in what the founding fathers believed and were given, that we have God-given rights, that we believe in limited government, that we believe in less taxation. They don't like those themes, so they try to undermine the personalities of our founding fathers. In each day and age, there's some aspect of a given society that one can say in subsequent societies looks immoral. There may be two in your generation. We have lost 50 million young people by abortions, by throwing their lives away. That probably is much more detrimental to our, since the Roe v. Wade decision in 1973. That's probably far more detrimental than slavery ever was, at least for those 50 million. But that doesn't mean that every person advocating any position in our country is wrong, even if they're pro-abortion today. We lose tens of thousands of young people, mostly young people, but tens of thousands of people on American roads every year driving. And they may look back and say, this generation was careless about slaughtering other human beings on the roads, but probably every young person in this room would want to get a license and drive as soon as you can. So it's easy to look back at a society at a particular time, find one fault with it, and then say that everything else that they suggested was wrong. Don't let the left do that to you. Let them face the substantive point that Mr. Gaby was making so that they don't just vilify Thomas Jefferson. Oh, he quoted Thomas Jefferson. He was a slaveholder. He was a deist. He was a person that extended liberty not only to Americans but throughout the world by his ideas and moved society forward dramatically in his day. So just that's a little preachy there. Who's the conservatism group? Why don't you come forward, please? Good to have you back.
Thank
Why don't you tell your name?
Just Jessica.
Great to have you with us.
Okay. So
is everyone sending up people that have been here before?
Oh, well, I've never spoken in front of everyone.
All right,
so
well, I'm glad you're doing so. Why don't you bring out 3 points that haven't been brought out before?
Okay, so I'm going to talk about free markets, capitalism, and strong military. So free markets focus on the idea of supply and demand and providing companies with the opportunities to produce a product that consumers would want to buy. And it's up to those companies whether they're able to succeed or not, and it's not the government's job to regulate it. And with capitalism, it's the opportunity of wealth. So conservatism likes to focus on not putting high taxes on the wealthy people and giving that money towards people who haven't worked as hard. It's pushing people to work hard and for the things that they earn. And then strong military, currently our national security is at risk, and we like to focus on strengthening our numbers so that we can protect the citizens of our country and make sure that everyone is safe, because if we don't have a strong military, we're not going to have a country to discuss any of these other issues. So that's one of our most important issues.
Very good. You're very well stated. Tell me when the United States has had a weaker military. Has it led to peace?
No.
Can you give me any examples of that?
Well, I mean, currently right now, we don't have our military over the past 8 years hasn't been as strong as it could be. And so, for example, we've led to things like ISIS, and we have treated like Israel. We've been terrible allies to them by supporting and funding countries that are our allies, and in turn, they're not going to be able to help us when there are countries in the Middle East that are, and Russia, that are developing like nuclear weapons and things like that, that can in turn hurt our country.
Mm-hmm. Jessica, this is the third time you've been with us, right?
Yes.
Good to have you back. Any questions for Jessica?
Yeah, so a lot of the time the left side likes to focus on taking away military funding, but that's not a solution to our problems. We need to keep our funding going towards our military instead of putting it towards something like healthcare and things like that, because without funds, how are we able to develop our weapons and keep on par with countries like Russia? They're developing weapons that surpass us by far. And so by keeping funding up, by increasing our like military programs, and by honoring our veterans, right now we're not doing that. Our VA hospitals and all of the treatment towards our VA, our vets, and by being more patriotic, we are going to be able to strengthen our military and the light that's shined on the people that are fighting for our country.
Let me give you one other suggestion on that. The United States views the military largely as defensive. In other words, we've taken on responsibilities, whether good or bad, to defend some of the countries that in the past we were at war with because they attacked us, like Japan or like Germany. And when you're defending, it's a much more difficult undertaking. One of the reasons the Nazis had such success in their military operations in the late 30s and early 40s is they were picking and choosing when they took the initiative. When you do that, you can have a smaller military. So sometimes people compare the United States military to Russia or to China and say, that's not a big deal. We're still a bigger military than they are. But our obligations is to try to defend freedom throughout the world And sometimes when you're on a defensive, you may have to have a threat in the Korean Peninsula one moment, in Europe, you know, Ukraine or Georgia, or the Baltics the next, or in the Middle East the next. And so when you're a defensive country, you probably need to be stronger. I'll give you another example where conservatives, though, strengthen the military. And it goes back to limited government. It goes back to central themes. When the left has controlled the United States, and particularly, let's go back to the Vietnam War, LBJ and the leftists in the country wanted the draft. They could have a very poor strategy in Vietnam because they had every young person, every young man at that time, they could draft and use as fodder in the way they were fighting the war. So if they had a bad strategy, just throw more young men into the meat grinder. All of the major conservatives, Bill Buckley, Barry Goldwater, Ronald Reagan, were for a voluntary military. They believed in limited government. They wanted a military and felt the military would ultimately be stronger and the country would be stronger if people who serve in the military choose to do so by their own volition. And that's an example of an area where conservatives have favored a stronger military that liberals won't concede, won't give us the credit for. So you need to be able to pull these things up as many times as you can in your discussions with liberals. Jessica, you did a great job. Great to have you back. Thank you very much. All right, what is conservatism? It gets tougher when you get to these end boards because a lot of the points have been covered. Glad to have you. Newcomer, right?
No, sir. It's my second year.
Good to have you with us again. I'm sorry.
Hello, y'all. Well, we had our 3 points were traditional values, limited government, and patriotism. And as he already said, it's kind of redundant. If I may, I would like to say that to me this is just a little bit deceiving, this format.
Okay.
Because when we look at some of our figureheads of our movement, like President Reagan and all of those who have come before us, it seems to me as though if they weren't picking out values that they liked, or they weren't choosing different policy matters and kind of patching it all together to make a movement that they liked. Rather, last year when I was at the conference, the biggest realization for me was that conservatism is a lens and a paradigm rather than a list of policy points. So let me give you an example. Limited government, one of my favorites. How many of you guys had to purchase airport food on your way here? Yeah. Yeah, I paid like $20 for 3 Cheerios the other day. That's painful. Well, and it hit me as I'm eating my Cheerios. If you think about the food, and I appreciate the comments by Mr. Gaby, the airport does have the ability to provide you with a lot of different options. They also control all the price points for the food. I didn't know if you knew that, but the airport has the ability to regulate at what price you pay for your cheeseburger. And so a lot of liberal proponents, when they say, oh, well, we really haven't had a socialist economy really be tried out, it hasn't even reached its full potential. If you look at the closed system of like an airport, for example, when indeed there is a system that is controlling all the points and setting it at, what happens? You pay $20 for Cheerios. It's not the capitalistic government that gives us the free, the cheaper products. It's the increased prices because that system is able to set their own points. Because, of course, what is the airport going to try to do? They're going to try to get more money. That's how the system works. And when you have a larger government, it's going to get more money. And they're going to make you pay $20 for Cheerios. That is how that fits into a system with limited government for me, and to see how this entire system all fits together. And I think that's important for us as we're marketing our movement to students in your high school, is that it's not a list of, oh, we're, you know, anti-abortion, and it's not a list of policy points, but it's rather it's an idea. It's a comprehensive philosophy that we'd like to use. So that is kind of the thoughts that we came up with.
Good. Anything else you want to add?
No, sir.
Any questions for Abraham? Sorry, I didn't realize you were here a year ago. Yes?
I just wanted to ask you a question.
Sure.
A lot of the boards have individual freedom and traditional values on them. Right. And a lot of people will say that those can be directly contradictory, like especially in the case of gay marriage. Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily saying that, but I was just wondering what your defense for that would be.
Well, individualism and traditional values. Part of individualism comes out of traditional values. Let me answer it theoretically, and then I'll zero in on the more specific part. Our traditional values include recognizing that we have a creator. We recognize him in the founding documents of our country. We recognize it in the founding statements of Young Americans for Freedom, that we have all we have God-given free will. And so that is a traditional value, that there is someone. Daniel Webster in his day was considered the greatest speaker in the United States. He was once asked when he left the stage, what was his most profound thought? And his answer was, at the end of life, there's an accounting. And that's a very traditional point of view, that you live your life with the understanding that there's a creator that you have to account to at the end of your life. And that leads to a lot of different decisions along the course of your life, if you're the average American. It certainly has for me. Rather than doing what my impulses might tell me at times, it gives me pause because of the traditional values, the religious values that my parents handed down, that maybe doing a particular action is probably not the best either for me in my soul, but really for society, and there's a reason why that's true. Why government is limited is a traditional value. So traditional values can include the very ideas of individual freedom, but it also, in today's parlance, includes items like the definition of marriage. Is marriage really between anyone that loves someone else? I think throughout history, that has not been the case. Traditional values would teach me I love my sister, but I can't marry my sister. Most liberals would even concede that. Probably is not a good idea. Why? I love her. She loves me. At least she tells me that. Michelle's not here this morning. I might say I love multiple women. I could say that. I'm not saying that. I could say that. But if they love me, which is probably improbable, why can't I marry multiple women? And so on. So part of traditional values is societies through the years have said, rightly so, that children come somehow from a mother and a father. You know, it may change in your lifetime. Hasn't changed yet in all of human history. And it takes a mother and a father, and the laws basically acknowledge that to some extent. Yes?
You talked a little bit about how the founding fathers and in the Constitution, they believed in the principles of natural law and that it was the position of the legislature to discover principles and laws that were already in place and not create them. So where do you draw the line between discovering those principles and putting into place laws that already exist that come from our creator or whatever higher authority that you believe in?
I think laws get respect. I'm not an anarchist. You shouldn't be an anarchist. You shouldn't say that there should be no laws. You can't protect a society as sophisticated as the United States from foreign attacks. You have to have some adjudication process to settle disputes. So you have to have some government. Where do you draw the line? Libertarians have a very hard time drawing the line is saying, all right, this is a legitimate role of government and this is not. That goes to the founding fathers. They limited government very strictly. They enumerated and laid out specifically those areas that they felt was the appropriate area for government to be involved. Beyond that, to change that, you needed to have an amendment and change the Constitution. And we've had amendments to do that. We had amendments to end slavery. So that's an example. But that's a pretty good framework for a modern-day American conservative, drawing that line in that particular case. The issue of right to life, some would say, the left is found in the shadows, the penumbra, they would say, of the Ninth Amendment, this idea that you have a right to abort your child. But we endowed our government to protect what?
Life,
liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So you could definitely argue, and I certainly do, that our founding fathers believed protecting human life was a core principle. I'm gonna, if I get a chance, I'll come back, but you'll have other speakers as well. Who represents the last board here? Good. Thomas, good to have you with us.
Thank you.
I'll give you this.
Yep.
Why don't you bring out some points that haven't been brought out already?
All right, I'll try to. One that has been mentioned, unfortunately, but I think is one that we should indefinitely try to elaborate on, is familial values. I think to conservatives, among all, familial values are very important to the way we live our lives and also the way that we interpret our Constitution and how our country should be run. And the next one I'd like to say is that success should be based on merits, not only heredity. And I think that's something that really ties into capitalism, because if we live in a world where even if you come from one of the lowest walks of life, if you pick up a mentor or a skill of some any degree, you can find success for yourself and work your way through the ranks. And there's sort of an artificial fabrication, if you will, that liberals have made that state, okay, I'm not working, I don't have any skill sets, but there's people who are and that do have skill sets that can provide for me, which I think is kind of backwards. And finally, we said that patriotism is definitely something that we try to exploit most of all in conservative values, because patriots are all for the country, regardless of who's in the White House, who's running our country. As long as you stick with what the Constitution says, why our country was formed, I think we could definitely, over time, prosper and eventually come to what we can all agree is the country that we all agree. You know what I'm trying to say.
I think so.
We can all
agree. Any questions for Thomas? You did a good job if they had no questions. Anyone want to bring out anything that they think was extremely important and wasn't brought out already? Yes.
The
Frank.
Word that I haven't heard in all of this is leadership.
Mm-hmm. It's a tough period. I'm going to give you one other item that I think was extremely important right now that's a core conservative value that no one brought out today, and that is the rule of law. Does anyone tell me what the rule of law is? Very important concept, particularly today. The rule of law is that once you pass a law, it should apply equally to all Americans. That's the rule of law. That if you're a private or a general in the United States Army and you give up secrets or you handle secrets of the United States in a way that our government has passed would send you to jail because you threaten the safety of other Americans, that law should be applied whether you're the Secretary of State or you're a private citizen in the United States. If you apply for a permit to open a business here in Santa Barbara, you should not get special privileges because you've made political donations to the city council men and women making that decision, that the law should be followed, that whatever requirements are to open a business, you should be treated individually. The rule, think of your teachers. If someone gets graded differently than you do, someone's talking in class all the time and never gets quiet time or sent to the principal, whatever's done today, but the other person, that person's the teacher's pet, but you get knocked on the head, or I used to get knocked on the head back in the day because I said something out of line, it runs against the core concept of rule of law. I thought you all brought out a lot of good points. Let me just reemphasize really what I was trying to say in this presentation with your help. Conservative personalities are going to be attacked. They're going to be denigrated. Every human being has flaws. The liberal media is not going to bring out the flaws of Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama. And you're will be tempted in debates to bring out the flaws of the people you're disagreeing with on different policy matters now and in the days ahead. But don't lose sight of what conservatism is. These are the principles. These are the ideas that we as a movement have to offer for America. A society that protects individual life, that treats human life just as well as the progressives would treat an endangered species or any species. The left today is great about talking about saving the environment and saving every obscure animal in the world, and I don't necessarily disagree with doing so. But they lose sight, but they don't want to do that to the human being, human role in society. They talk about trying to protect the most vulnerable. The most vulnerable are the unborn or the newly born, and the left doesn't really focus or care about that. We believe in individualism. You make better decisions than the government will make for you. Ronald Reagan, no one said we're just for lower taxes. But when Ronald Reagan dealt with that issue, he had a three-sentence approach to it, and he used it most consistently in talking to the American people. He said the person who earns the income should have the biggest say over how it's going to be spent. How many of you agree with that? If you earn the income, you should have the biggest say over how it's going to be spent. Does everyone agree with that? Does anyone disagree with that? His next sentence would be, that person will make a better decision than a bureaucrat in Washington or Sacramento. How many of you agree with that? He said, therefore, I'm for lower taxes. He didn't just jump to lower taxes. He started with two predicates that almost everyone would agree with. Limited government allowing you to make individual decisions with the money that you earn is extremely important. And not just the money you earn, other things in life as well. The rule of law, we talked about. Free speech, we didn't talk about that. The left doesn't believe in free speech in your high school. They don't believe it in the college campuses. One of you said you don't have any rights because you're not 18 yet. That's actually not true. The United States Supreme Court in the Tinker case said that as high school students, you have the right of free speech, that you don't give it up at the schoolhouse door. You do have rights as American citizens. You do have rights even if you're under 18. Pro-life, limited government, economic freedom, the ability to form a business, keep it going. The Second Amendment, it's not just to protect yourself. It's to protect your family. I grew up in the inner city, and we were heavily armed. Our family was hunters. But when there was riots that included smashing my father's store when I was there, we were not attacked further. People didn't come through the threshold of our store because people in our neighborhood knew we were an armed family. We had shotguns loaded with rock salt, not to kill anyone, but to protect our lives and our property. That wasn't just an individual right. That was a family right. That was a community right. When the LA riots existed, the Korean businesses, a lot of them acquired or had machine guns to protect their property. The Korean businesses were left alone. Sometimes they talk about 15 days warning. If suddenly a gang is attacking your family and threatening your brother or your sister or your parents, you don't want to wait 15 days in order to be armed. That's a fundamental right. We believe it's a God-given right. We don't believe government is in position to take it away. So it's not just the Second Amendment. It's the right of free exercise of religion. The left talks about freedom of worship. They believe that you should have the right to worship in your church or your synagogue or your temple for an hour or a week or so, but not bring that into wider society. There's a difference between freedom of worship and what the founding fathers talked about, free exercise of religion. Yes?
Off of what you're talking about, the Second Amendment and the rule of law, I wanted to hear your opinion on politicians being bumped up the line when signing up for a concealed weapons permit.
What about politicians being bumped up the line when they seek a concealed weapons? Look. The liberal politicians have abused these laws for a long time. One of the biggest advocates of, and I don't fault them for being defended, but one of the biggest advocates of gun control taken away from other Americans was Teddy Kennedy. Ted Kennedy was at one point threatened on Capitol Hill, and his aides pulled out Uzis and machine guns. They were all set, and they should have been, to protect him. He had lost two brothers who were killed. This goes to the rule of law. Politicians should live under the same laws that they enact. And if Barack Obama wants to restrict everyone else from being protected, why is he special? He's the president of the United States, but this is an egalitarian society. He would argue that it should be. And so you need to follow the laws. If you're putting in place a law that restricts other people's rights, it ought to apply for you as well. My overall point is these are principles worth fighting for. These are principles worth being involved in promoting. The left will denigrate these by attacking the personalities, just as I attacked Mr. Gaby when he cited Thomas Jefferson. I didn't attack him. I didn't attack Mr. Gaby. I attacked the concept that he used, Thomas Jefferson. You all knew problems with Thomas Jefferson. When asked to give the positive, you didn't jump to the positives. But there are many positives that Thomas Jefferson gave our society, and they're mostly tied around these principles that we have in front of us today. You have other speakers, but you're going to go to the Reagan Ranch. And you're there as a person, an individual who believed in limited government, who believed in returning to you as the American people as many decisions in your own life as possible, who knew that a strong foreign policy included giving the incentive, giving the encouragement to freedom fighters throughout the world, not necessarily always fighting for them, but standing up on their behalf. So his early addresses, radio addresses from the ranch, encouraged solidarity, encouraged the people beleaguered behind the Iron Curtain to stand up for their own principles. It led to a rebirth of freedom, if you will, that your parents and you have enjoyed to a much greater extent than was thought possible before Ronald Reagan became president. Delighted to have you with us. Abraham, I apologize, I forgot you were with us before. We love having new students with us. Most of you are, but we also encourage you to come back and be involved with Young America's Foundation now and in the years to come. Thank you very much.